everybody. I'm sorry I'm over here. I was hoping to be walking fully by now, but turns out I'm really clumsy and it just didn't happen for me. So I will be around all day. Lots of my lab team is here. If you have questions about Lubbock, there's quite a few of them that have been involved directly in it, and they can answer your questions and they can help you out. So today I'm going to talk about some of the work that we've been doing with Lubbock Mealybug. We've got some idea of what we're doing after 3 years of work. There's still a lot of challenges ahead. So I'm going to show you some of the more recent data. And for each bit of data that's probably been done by a postdoc or a student in my lab, I'm going to point out who they are because they're probably here, aside from one person who left to get a faculty job somewhere else, and tell you a little bit about what we're learning as we're learning it. I know this is a challenge for a lot of people, and particularly those of you who have cups houses, this has been a huge challenge, and we're still working on it, so please bear with us. Uh-oh, what'd I do? Okay, sorry, okay. So Lubbock Mealybug, if you've been at any of the extension events the last few years, I've been talking about it because it has been an emerging pest and it's been causing a lot of damage. And we really just, as Michael said earlier, we do not need more damage in our systems. We do not need more problems. It's interesting as an entomologist, but it's not good for us industry-wide. So we know that it's been here since 2009, but it never really took hold in citrus until 2019. When a couple of growers contacted me and said, I have this really weird damage. I think it might be cottony cushion scale, can you please come check it out? And when I got there, I mean, I was excited because I'd never seen cottony cushion scale before, but it was not. And so we had to work with the state to figure out who we were dealing with. And it turns out it is a mealybug that we haven't really dealt with in the US, North America really much at all. And it's what we're calling it Lubbock mealybug. If you know, want to look on your own for it, its scientific name is Nipococcus viridis. My professional society calls it hibiscus mealybug, and pretty much everywhere else in the world calls it spherical mealybug, so it gets really confusing looking for stuff. What we do know now, and we didn't know when we first started this, is that it only attacks above ground portions of the tree. Some literature suggested that it might have gone to the roots, but we've never found it on the roots. We've dug up quite a few trees. It's only going to be above ground portions of your tree. We know that it's attracted to damage. And I don't know if I'm going to have time to show you data from that today, but my PhD student, David Olby, has been doing some work on that, and we do see attraction to damage, which suggests there might be some volatile components to that. So we're working towards developing an attractive lure, which, of course, takes time, but hopefully it'll be something that'll make scouting easier. We also know that they like developing fruit, as you can see with that image on the screen. This was actually from an infestation that happened last year in January, when it was really warm right before we got the cold snap. They had a huge amount of infestation on this early set fruit, and almost all of it dropped before it ever had a chance, which probably weren't going to harvest fruit that you had developing at this point of the year. So probably not a huge loss, but not great in terms of long-term population in that field. We also know, and if you're experiencing it, you're going to see fruit distortion and drop, branch dieback, gets more dramatic as the population gets heavier. And this is our current distribution in citrus. And now it actually has moved on to some other host crops. I'm going to show you that on the next slide. But this is just in citrus where we're seeing it, and there's been some in the residential citrus. So you might hear from somebody, hey, I've got this at my home. What the heck is this? Just tell them to clip it and burn it and just get rid of it if possible. They can freeze it, but freezer space can be, you know, at a premium depending on your household. So we do have it. It is spreading. And unfortunately, it's also really easy to spread. So I'm going to show you some information towards the end of this on how to reduce that. These are the other hosts that we found it on so far in Florida. There's 49 hosts now, I think. And worldwide, we know that there's 144 known hosts, and that's just before it came to North America. So there's a really large potential here in fruit crop trees and in horticultural trees, you know, things that we make a lot of money off of here in Florida. So this is concerning. You know, if you grow other stuff, keep an eye out for it. If you find it on something new, please send it into the state so we can help document it and figure out how to manage it. I know we focus on citrus, but citrus, our pests often roll onto other things, and if we can work together with those other systems, we can come up with better solutions. So a lot of the focus of my group for the last few years has been trying to reduce the amount of loss that we're going to have, because when we first found it, the fields that were heavily impacted had high levels of fruit drop, and you knew who it was because you'd see this distorted, tiny, little shriveled up fruit on the ground. So we wanted to take advantage of the seasonal biology when designing these management programs. So this is going to be, the next couple slides will be some work that my student David has been doing And we wanted to use that to help you figure out when to time your chemistry applications. Maybe we need to think about what we're putting out based on the life stages that are present in the field. Oh, and just for reference, I know I've shown some of these pictures before, the picture on the left was actually some trees that were under IPCs. IPCs do not prevent this pest. IPCs make it really hard to find this pest. So you should be checking your IPCs periodically. They will suck your tree dry if they get under there and they're not controlled. The tree on the right is from a cup's house, and you can see whole branches that were just sucked dead and dry. They wound up removing this tree so it wasn't a source for other trees because it was just so heavily infested. So as I mentioned, David's been working on the population biology, and I haven't had a chance to see who all's here today, but if the growers are here who worked with him, thank you. We really appreciate that. So one of the things we wanted to find out is there reproduction tied to the flush cycle? We know a lot of the pests that we deal with, they are, so we can really target flush, and we can think about managing based on that. Unfortunately, this mealybug is not particularly interested in flush, and it's not really tied to the flush cycle. So this is kind of your traditional population cycle, just to show you what's going on in each time of the year. And what we do find is that, so on here, the adult males, which are pretty inconsequential, we've come to realize that they don't rely on males to mate. They don't need them to have offspring. It'll increase the number of offspring they have, but they don't require them. So unlike a lot of mealybugs, we can't target males with volatile attractant lures to try to pull them out of the system, which would be super easy. But we can't. It's just not going to work here. So that's the red line on the bottom. The blue line is the adult females, and you see that they're pretty steady. Once the spring kind of hits, the female amount's pretty steady, around 3 to 4 females. This is per sample that we took, and he was taking 20-centimeter samples back to the lab from infested trees and going through them and counting all the life stages present, and it took a really long time to do. And so there's the females are pretty abundant. You're not really going to kill most of them with most contact insecticides. They're going to be buried under that wax. They're going to be really hard to get to. But the good news for us is we actually have a lot of the immatures, and these we can kill with almost anything. So we actually had this nice target of what to look at as far as when we can think about trying to target our management. So you want to think about getting something, if you're going to get a systemic in before fruit set, that'll reduce your population going forward, and then we can think about working with our other things that we unfortunately still have to keep spraying until we have a good predator in the system. And I am going to talk about some predators this afternoon, but I'm just focusing on some of the basic biology here. And just another way to look at this data is actually, this is kind of different looking, but I really like this chart because this really does show you who's out there. So again, the adult males, tiny slice of the population, adult females a little bit bigger, and you know, certain times of year, like fruit set, and then later in the late summer, early fall, you're getting higher female populations. But there's a lot of immatures. These still have wax, but we can get through that wax with most of our pesticides because there's a lot of still vulnerable area on them. And there's a lot of crawlers. So for every one female, assume you're gonna have at least 500 eggs, which means potentially 500 crawlers or more. I think the egg range was up to 1,000 per female that David was looking at. So they have a high reproductive capacity. So we do need to think about knocking them back if you're affected by them. And the great thing is crawlers are super easy to kill. Oil kills them. So even just incorporating oils in your sprays can help keep them down. So for those of you who have not encountered this mealybug, I'm going to show you the pictures of the life stages here. And David was kind enough to actually set up some petri dishes in the back that you can go look at, and you can see what they look at under the microscope, and you can also take the nice little lens we gave you and go see what it's gonna look like if you see it in your field. So up here we have, this is a little bitty crawler. These are super duper tiny. When I talk to people about this, and I'm gonna tell you this right now, I call them grains of pepper with legs. You are probably not gonna see this in your field unless you have a huge cluster of them. They're so incredibly small, and they're also very, very fast. This is probably who's getting picked up and moved around by us, by the wind, by our equipment, by any animals that are in your field, and unfortunately, also by ants. We have seen them move them around in the field. Yeah, yay ants. And then we have some slightly older juveniles here. These are gonna be about second to third instars, start getting a little wax when they get in that nice little third instar, and then they're gonna start getting really waxy right after this, and that's when they're hard to kill. They get really hard to kill when that wax covers them. And the other life stages you'll see, this is an ovisac. So inside of here is adult female, mated or unmated. She's gonna make this ovisac. She's gonna pop out a bunch of eggs. And this is what the eggs look like. They're kind of this reddish purple color. And one of the ways that you can actually take advantage of that coloration, if you see this bug in your field, squish it. If you get purple goo on your hands, you have Lubbock mealybug. Now, if you have sprayed and you still have a population in your field, before you spray again, about 14 days after you spray, go out there and squish some. See if they crumble. If they crumble, they're dead. If they're still purple, you really need to think about what you're going to do next. And you're welcome to call me. I'll help you out, figure out what we know to do. All right, so I'm going to move into some of the chemical work. Some of this is new. We've done some in the past. In this past year, we were able to move this into the groves. And so this is work that's been done by Emily DeMarge. She's a postdoc in my group. She's going to be talking about rust mites later because she's actually an acarologist, but I also make her work on mealybugs. So what we did here is we went out in the field and we sprayed a couple different chemistries. When you're looking at the graphs, this is week 0, week 1, week 2, week 3, and all the chemistries that we looked at are along the bottom, and it transfers up for the whole thing. These are just your contact chemistries. And so what we did is we went out and we sprayed the field, and then we brought back leaves weekly to kind of look at what the residues were doing on here, because we not only do you want to know the initial kill of something that comes onto the plant, but do I get any residue off of it? Is it going to work past a day? So we apply in the field, come back, add mealybugs, so we knew how many mealybugs we were starting with, and also because we populations are pretty sporadic in our groves, so we need to make sure we had mealybugs. And then we would check them for 7 days after we put them on the plants to see if there's acute toxicity, so they die within a day or two, or if it took a couple days and then they died. And we would look and see if their legs were moving underneath the microscope. It's a pretty easy telltale. They do walk off the leaf occasionally, but they usually come back because they want to feed. So what we found on this particular, oh, there's a typo, I'm sorry. On this particular test is that Agriflex and Transform had over a 60% mortality in that first week. So we sprayed it, then we took the leaves back, put them on it. They died pretty darn fast. That was good. But that kind of decreases with some of the other chemistries. So in this test, Volume Selexi had 30% mortality in that first week. In other tests that we've done, we've actually had higher mortality with some of these chemistries. So it might be just a little bit variable by the organisms and by the week, by the time of the year. But we do have some stuff that we can use that we know is going to have a little bit of knockdown on them. But these are some good options for your population growth stages, so those juveniles. And this isn't the end-all be-all. I've shown you guys data in the past of other chemistries that can be incorporated that'll work. This is just what we were working with this particular test. Then we also looked at some of the systemic chemistries. So same setup here, week 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and the chemistries at the bottom. So we were looking at Movento, Sunstar, Savanto, Sunstar plus an adjuvant and oil, and Movento. So we also did oil or non-ionic surfactant to see if there's a difference there, if one of them worked a little bit better. And so we did the same thing. We applied it in the field, field-aged leaves, brought them back to the lab, put mealybugs on them, and watch them to see what happened. So we were actually kind of surprised that we had that high mortality in week 0. That was really unexpected, but we think that actually might have been an effect of the adjuvant coating their bodies. We use second to third instar, so they're fairly easy to kill. The adult females are a different beast to work with, so we really try to target these life stages that are more abundant to get data that's more useful. So the latter weeks, your mortality is going to fluctuate as the product builds up in the tree. So it takes some time for these systemic chemistries to really build up and be effective. I don't know what rate's the best yet. That's going to be in the next set of tests, is what rate do I really need to use? We had a couple different rates for certain chemistries that we were interested in, and I'll have more data by Expo, I promise. So we also looked at some soil-applied chemistries. This was actually done by a previous postdoc, Eric Middleton. Some of you guys probably met him at other extension events. And for this one, the graphs are going to be laid out just a little bit differently. Week 2, 4, and 6 after application, most of our chemistries lost efficacy after week 6, so we I chose not to show those data because there's nothing there. And we looked at, of course, our control trees, Admire, which we use the common drench, Aldicarb. I know that has a very limited use label, and mealybugs is actually something that usually works really well with that particular chemistry. Belay, Platinum, Savanto, and Verimark. And as you can see, the soil applied, we did have some higher kill in that first week, which was surprising because we literally just applied the material. So there's some natural mortality. Well, I'm totally going to go over. Sorry. But by week 6, we actually still had some decent residual. But it took time for this chemistry to build up in these trees. And these were healthy trees. They'd been under IPCs prior to experimentation. So they didn't already have HLB, so it just takes some time to get in there. All right, so put it all together, thinking about what we use and when. So right now, and this might change next year when I have more data, but right now it looks like systemic pre-fruit set application of chemistry is going to be really good to reduce your reproductive females. So get that number down early, kind of like we talked about with the psyllids. You do that overwintering spray. It's not quite winter with these guys. You want to be looking at fruit set. And some of our systemics do have Be Safe labels, so you can spray them towards the end of your bloom. You'll be fine. And just make sure you check your label of what you're using. And then later in the season, we can think about using knockdowns, because if you keep that female population down and you can continue to keep it down, you're probably going to be okay. As long as you can knock down the juvenile populations periodically, you won't get to the females. Kill the young ones, you don't get adults. Mixing in materials with residual activity would be good for reducing the adults. We still have a lot more work to do here. We had some major delays with COVID, and now we're back up and chugging with all of our research. It just takes time to get these done. I will note that we did not include the IGR on this. There's a insect growth regulator that actually works really well on most scales and mealybugs, but we have not taken it to outside field tests. We've done it in the laboratory. We've used it under IPCs. And it's probably going to work really good in cups, but I haven't had a chance to test it yet. It works fantastic on most mealybug and scales, and so that is a chemistry that is really worth considering. It's kind of expensive, but it's worth every penny. So non-chemical management, I'm going to talk about predators in the afternoon. We do have some predators that are establishing. They look really promising, so that is something to keep your eyes out for. And I'll show you pictures of what everybody looks like. And we have a new biocontrol specialist. She wasn't able to be here today, but she's taking this mealybug on as one of her pet projects. So she's working on seeing what we have out there that's effective and possibly if we need to supplement it from with other predators from outside the region. One thing that we do know, and I'm going to talk about ants again this afternoon with more data, is that ants can really reduce your efficacy of your predators. They actually will fight the predators because they're farming the mealybugs for their honeydew, easy sugar source. So we got to think about ant management as part of growth management. We got to really think about bringing that back. I know we kind of got lax on it, but I'll show you data later to help you figure out what you might want to do here. And so we do see that ant management can reduce spread and survival of the mealybugs, because if you get the ant numbers down, the predator's numbers can go up if you have them in your fields. So thinking about putting baits into your management plan is going to be really, really useful. So sanitation is also something to think about. That's my head, actually, after crawling under that tree I showed you guys earlier from cups. It was so loaded with mealybugs that they were all over me. So, yeah, it was a great demo of we can pick these up, no problem. That wax is super duper duper sticky. It's unlike any other mealybug wax I've ever played with. And it's interesting, but it's really not great for us. So we need to think about how we sanitize if we're moving between fields, especially if you're somewhere that's really infested and going to somewhere that you don't think is infested yet. We don't want it to get infested. So sanitation tools, equipment, and personnel where possible, these things need to be incorporated. If you own a nursery and you get this thing in there, we got to clean you up. You're going to have a big problem. So thorough coverage with 70% or greater of isopropyl alcohol, the stuff you can go buy at Walmart, CVS, just go buy that stuff. Get a good coating. It'll kill almost all the life stages. Not the adult female, unfortunately. I can't give you anything that won't hurt you to use. So you can kill a lot of the juveniles, a good thorough run of your clothing through the laundry. Detergent breaks up the oviscac quite well. Wash your clothes after you've been in the field. Try not to share stuff. We've also found that boiling water or steam for 10 minutes at 120 degrees Fahrenheit will kill all of the life stages. So if you're looking at sanitation, especially if you're like a nursery owner or you have access to this type of stuff, small equipment can easily be sanitized. We don't have great methods for trucks and stuff yet, but if you run it through the car wash periodically, that's probably going to help reduce the spread, just because, again, the detergent will help break down the oviscac and wash it off. I know I'm a little over. So lots of people to say thank you to, and the funding sources. And I will be around all day, so feel free to ask questions later. Doesn't look like my email address made it on here, but it's kind of a distinct last name. You can find me.